Good morning. Happy Sabbath to each one of you. Even though the sun is not shining outside, I hope it is inside. Some of you have perhaps have been south for some of the winter already. If you haven't, some of you I know are anticipating going, and some are leaving. So I wish them safe traveling mercies. Welcome to the Lansing Seventh-day Adventist Church. It's a joy to be in the Lord's house on this beautiful Sabbath day. I have a few announcements to make. I'm going to call on Abby first to come up. Would you, please?
Good morning, church family. My announcement this morning is for the Adventist Youth Ministries. Our kickoff date is January 28th, and that is just a couple Sabbaths away. We are so excited to start this new, different and interactive Bible study with our youth. A reminder, it is for fifth grade and above, so if you have kids that you know in that age range, we would love to have them join us. We're really excited about kicking this off. Again, if you still want to be able, or if you still want to volunteer to help us out with this new program, please see Heather Perez. And so we're so excited. January 28th, we'll be kicking off, and we really hope to see you and all of the youth there.
Thank you, Abby. I'm going to invite our personal ministries director at this time to come up, if you would.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. So, I've been up here a couple times over the course of the last couple months talking about 2017 and what we're going to be doing. And today is the beginning of the Capital City Crusade. Amen. So, we are prepared today for outreach. Today at 2 o'clock, our communications team will be leading out, and we have packets for...
They are New Year, New You packets. So the idea is, it's a new year, and so we put information in there for their spiritual health, their physical health, and emotional health, as well as the BibleStudyOffer.com cards with the Strong Tower radio on the back. So this should be very, very easy for us to be able to pass out and say, hey, this is to help you with your New Year's resolutions, New Year, New You. And so he'll tell us a little bit about where we're going.
So today at 2 o'clock, we're just going to need all of you here. Okay, amen. Everyone, we're going to need you here. And then we're going to head out to three local areas. We have the Lansing Town Center, which has which is off of Saginaw. That's going to have your Target and Planet Fitness. And then we're also going to go into the mall, the Lansing Mall parking lot, and we're going to work the parking lot and meet as many people as we can. And the last spot that we're looking at is the Delta Town Place, located just west of 96, which has your Walmart, it has your Lowe's, your Menards. So busy parking lots, lots of people, lots of friends for us to make. And lots of people that we can offer some wellness to, some spirituality to, and Bible studies. So we're hoping to see everyone here. Amen, everyone. Okay, we'll see y'all at 2 o'clock. Thank you.
If you haven't already looked in your bulletin, there's a piece of paper. It looks like this. I believe the color is blue, at least looks blue to me. First thing I want to mention is up on the screen as you came in this morning, you may have noticed that we are celebrating the 10 days of prayer. That will continue. We've already had three nights. I was able to get to two of them, and what a blessing it is to be able to sing songs of praise to the Lord and also to get on our knees and thank Him and put special requests before Him as our church looks at the new year. So 10 days of prayer is on. It's at 7 o'clock downstairs in the fellowship room, and I certainly want to invite all of you that can to be there. As some of you know, there's a fellowship meal that's listed there, and that is going on right after church. All of you that are hungry, didn't bring food, but need a place to go, you're welcome. And they've already outlined the type of food and fruits and so forth that we will have. You've heard a lot about the community outreach. I'm here to tell you that what Paul just said was significant. We have, as a church, designed and developed a program around personal ministries. Personal ministries is not inward, it's outward. And what they're doing, as he just explained, is they're going out in the community. They're going to do this the first Sabbath of every month. So put that on your calendar, or is it the second Sabbath? Second Sabbath of each month, thank you. So please prepare for that. And they're having packets this time to pass out today, and there'll be different things in time. And they want to go out and reach out to the community, invite them to come and be a part of our fellowship, as well as to do Bible studies. And of course, if you look down a little further, you're going to see it won't be long in next month, in March, when we're having the dental clinic, which involves the entire community. So that's an exciting time, as it was last year. Lastly, I want to mention that this evening here at 5 o'clock, we are having a celebration time, a celebration for outreach for the new year, and particularly we're so pleased to have Strong Tower Radio here, and they're going to be presenting a praise time as well and thanking us for all the support that they are receiving. I think you'll enjoy it, and I believe their quartet will be here to sing for us as well. As we enter into the service this morning, I would like to share with you a precious text that's found in Psalms 150. It's a praise text. It's one that tells us to lift up our heads and raise our voices and sound praise to our Heavenly Father. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord in His sanctuary and praise Him for His mighty firmament. Praise Him in His mighty acts. Praise Him according to His excellent greatness. Praise Him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise Him with the lute and the harp. Praise Him with the timbrels and dance. Praise Him with stringed instruments and flutes. Praise Him with loud cymbals. Praise the Lord with clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Church family, please kneel with us as we sing our introit, Father, We Love You.
Precious Father, this morning we come one more time into your presence, one Sabbath closer to eternity, where we will spend not another Sabbath separated from you, but we will be face to face with you. We long for that day. But even today, Lord, we can have a glimpse of heaven. We can see and experience and sense your power and your spirit working in our hearts today. As we yield ourselves to you during this hour, we pray, Lord, that your presence would be in our midst and that you would draw us sweetly close to each one. May our hearts this morning be encouraged as we lift up our voices to you, as we pray, as we sing, as we give our tithes and offerings, as we open and study the word. May, Lord, your love be in our midst, and may our worship be pleasing to you because of the righteousness of your Son Jesus, which we claim as ours by faith. And we come in his name. Let all God's people say, Amen.
Amen. We're going to start our time of praise this morning by singing number 428, The Sweet By and By. And as we sing these words this morning, let's imagine that we are there with our Heavenly Father in that sweet by and by.
There's a land that is fairer than day.
Opening hymn, if you would please stand with us, is 229, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
Join in the everlasting.
Good morning, church family. Happy Sabbath to you. How are you this morning? Are you trusting in the Lord in 2017? I hope that many of you have renewed your commitments to spend time with the Lord each day in Bible study and prayer. Amen? Or that rather not renewed them, because that means you would have left them behind, but that you deepen those commitments. Amen? And so we praise the Lord. I'll talk more a little bit about that. It's good to see each one of you. It's good to be back. And I'll give you a little report here in just a little bit. But we are having a special moment this morning for our ministry moment. And I'm going to invite the Cabose family and friends, if you would come up, Rachel, Greg, and Austin, and the rest of the family that's here visiting with them today. And we have an opportunity to dedicate a young person to the Lord. Amen? And it's a very special time. And I was told that I was once dedicated to the Lord when I was a baby. I didn't know that, but my mother told me that. And my son and daughter have both been dedicated, and it's a precious time. And he's very happy about this. He's been looking forward to this day since his birth. Amen? And so I can't think of two more wonderful parents than Rachel and Greg, and a blessing that they have been both to our church. And, you know, I can say that I would feel very comfortable, or I would feel very happy if they were my parents, because they both love the Lord. And really, what it really takes to be a godly parent is to love the Lord with all your heart, be committed to His truth, and seek Him for great wisdom. Amen? And I believe that Greg and Rachel have both, all three of those qualities, and I know that they're going to raise little Austin and the Lord. We also have grandparents here, Linda and Tony, and are the other grandparents here? Joe and Melissa. And so we're glad that they are here with us as well. And siblings in the back. We won't leave you guys out. Let's. Jason, Carrie, Nathan, and Janine.
And so we have a few more out in the queue.
A few more that weren't ready to come up. Will you guys just raise your hand wherever you are? You guys are welcome to come up if you'd like to in support of the family. But that's okay if you don't want to do that. Well, I just have a few words for you that I always love to share with parents who are new parents and dedicating their children to the Lord. And it's from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 6. And I think this is so powerful. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 3, it says, verse 5, it says, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And these words which I command you today shall be in your hearts." And that's the most important thing for little Austin as he grows up, as you guys teach him about the Lord, as you have family worship each day, as you spend time with the Lord together as a family unit, both individually and as a family unit, that the love of God would be in your hearts richly. And that will be the outsource, the spring from which every command, every teaching, every truth, every principle that you share with Austin as he grows, that's where that will come from the love of God that's in your heart for him and for each other. And as he sees you guys loving each other, he'll know what true love is, and as you love him. Then he continues and says, "You shall teach them, and these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them while you sit in the house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on your doorposts of your house and on your gates." And so that everything that you guys do, everything that you, that every choice you make, every word you say, every expression you give would be to Austin, revealing the love and the truth of God for him. And you are commissioned by God today to lead Austin to Christ, to train him to be a disciple of Christ, to first lead him to the Lord, to accept him as Savior, and then teach him to be a disciple. and to grow him in the ways of the Lord. And I love this. On the same chapter, it says this in verse 20. It says, when your son asks you in time to come, saying, what is the meaning of the testimonies, the statutes, and the judgment which the Lord our God has commanded you? When your son, one day he's going to come to you and he's going to ask you questions. What does this mean? Why do we do this? Why do we go to church? Why do we read the Bible? What do these things mean? You'll be able to say this. Then you shall say to your son, we were slaves of Pharaoh in Egypt. We're all slaves in the house of sin, aren't we? And the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand. And the Lord showed signs and wonders before our eyes, great, severe, against Egypt, Pharaoh, and his household. And he brought us out from there that he might bring us in to give us the land which he swore our fathers. And that's a beautiful thing, isn't it? And that's the testimony that you will give to him, that this is why, because the Lord has delivered us, and the Lord loves us, and he loves little Austin. And so we look forward to seeing Austin grow up in the Lord. And I know that you guys are going to teach him the ways of godliness, the ways of holiness, the ways of truth, and the ways of love. And we believe that. Now, you guys, I think, have something you'd like to share as well for Austin.
We chose a scripture that we felt would be a good aim and goal and hope for our son as he grows. And also, it contains a promise of what God will do to accomplish that in his life.
It comes from 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 23 and 24, which says, may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you, Austin, through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you, Austin, is faithful, and he will do it.
It's a beautiful passage, amen? And so, Greg and Rachel, grandparents, siblings, aunts and uncles, cousins, the Lord has called you to give an account for this young man in the kingdom of God. It's a serious business. It's an eternal business. But there's a God of heaven who has the richest treasures, the greatest love, and the most wonderful truth to guide you and to assist you. And as you pray to him and as you call upon him in wisdom, he's going to bless you. Amen, church? So I want to ask you, parents, grandparents, family, aunts and uncles, do you guys accept the Lord's call upon your life to train up young Austin and the ways of the Lord, and the ways of his truth, to surround him with love, to surround him with happiness, and making sure that even though sometimes it may be difficult to say no, that for the good of his character and the good of his future, that you'll be willing to do whatever's best for him in the eyes of God. Is that your desire this morning? Church family, I also challenge you, because it's not just their responsibility, but we have a broader responsibility to surround them with our arms and our love and to lift up them in prayer and also to help them raise young Austin, to show him love and to teach him through Sabbath school and all these different things to also follow in the ways of the Lord. You accept that commission, church family? If you do, say amen. Amen. All right, before we're going to have prayer, we're going to have a dedicatory prayer, so I'm going to invite the elders to come. But before we do that, Judy's going to come, and she has something from the school as well.
Over 100 years ago, the Seventh-day Adventist Church began Adventist education to be there for parents, to be part of when you leave the home, to help your boys and girls to know Jesus better. And we're thrilled with that. And we want to just keep surrounding our children and to help you as you get him started in school one day. I know it seems like a long time from now. But we have a certificate for him for a month of free tuition in kindergarten. And as you think ahead and keep focused on heaven, we have a little bit of advertisement. wish you the very, very best and enjoy your time.
Believe me, stay up here, Judy, and be a part of the prayer if you would. Believe me, it goes fast. I can tell you from experience.
Amen.
Amen. So I'd like to invite the elders to come forward, and as they're coming, we're going to just surround the family, and maybe we could just kind of squeeze together and make room for the elders. Elders will surround you guys. We have a gift for you. It's a gift card to the ABC so that you can go and choose something for family worship for you guys, to the Book Center. And also we have the certificate of dedication that we want to present to you guys, and there's a smaller one in the bag as well. Is it possible if we could just kneel together, and we'll just ask the Lord's blessing, and elders, if you would, lay hands on the family, and wherever you can. Yes, absolutely. Precious Father, Lord, we lift little Austin up to you this morning. We just pray that your Spirit would come upon him, and that, Lord, he would grow as Jesus did in favor with you and with his fellow men. And, Lord, that you would bless him as you did Jesus growing up, that you would teach him the ways of your eternal kingdom, that your Spirit would just whisper in his ear those things that he needs to know, and give wisdom to the family, to the grandparents, to the aunts and uncles, and especially to Greg and Rachel. And I just pray, dear Lord, that your Spirit would be in them, and they would give them strength during the trials ahead, Lord. It's not easy. It's actually quite difficult to raise children in your ways. And Lord, with all the temptations of the world and all the distractions, I just pray, Father, that you would keep him in the palm of your hand, that he would become yours. He is yours today. We are giving him to you. Greg and Rachel are offering him to you as and recognizing, Lord, that he's a gift from you to them. And Lord, they want to present him to you when Jesus comes in the eyes of eternity. And so, Lord, we pray your blessing upon their family, and may you richly draw them close to your heart, and may your strength be in their home as they kneel each day and offer prayer to you. We ask all these things, Lord, and thank you for them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, it only seems appropriate after a dedication to have the children's story, doesn't it? So it's time now for the little ones to come forward. If you've ever wondered what the money that they collect goes for, it goes for the Worthy Student Fund. And I was just thinking, you know, it's kind of a habit that we pull out a bunch of ones. But you know, even though they're little, a 5 or a 10 or a 20 doesn't weigh anymore. They'll still be able to get it up here. So let's sing Jesus Loves Me as they collect our funds.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. So Jesus loves me, he who died.
happy Sabbath, and I want to thank you all for coming up here so nicely. Thank you. You guys all did that so well. And I want to say happy Sabbath. And I also want to tell you that I always know when it's time for me to do a children's story because the Lord pops a story right into my head. And I praise his name, and I thank him for that. Who likes to read? Raise your hand. Okay, I see some hands up. Who loves to read? Raise your hand. Okay, I still see a lot of hands. Great. Well, you know what? I love to read too. And when I was young, I could not wait until it came time in school for me to get that little paper form that had a bunch of books on it. And I could buy these little books for a quarter, 50 cents, and some of the bigger ones would even be $1.25. And I couldn't wait to get those books home and start reading them. I'd be so excited. But you know what? I also have a favorite book. And this book is a hardcover, and I don't even know where I got it, but it's my favorite book. Because this book taught me a life lesson that I made a part of my life, and I still do today. In fact, this book not only was a book, but it also became a popular movie. And the name of the book and the name of the movie is Pollyanna. Pollyanna, it was a story about a little girl, and her name was Pollyanna. And Pollyanna, she was an orphan. Her mom and her dad had both passed away and went to sleep. But Pollyanna was lucky because she had an aunt that she could go live with. The aunt was wealthy and had a lot of money. But when Pollyanna got to the aunt's house, she discovered that her aunt was strict. And her aunt wasn't a very happy person. But Pollyanna was a happy person. And everyone always asked Pollyanna, why was she so happy all the time? And she said that when she was a little girl and she was living with her father, who was a missionary, she would wait for donations to come in because donations would come in a missionary barrel. And Pollyanna, she did not have a doll. And she wished and wished for a doll. Well, the missionary barrel came in, and she waited and waited. There was no doll in the missionary barrel. All that was in the missionary barrel was a pair of crutches. So Pollyanna's dad said to Pollyanna, honey, why don't you think of something to be glad for? And she thought and she said, well, I will be glad that I don't have to use these crutches. So that was a new game that Pollyanna and her dad would always play. They would always look at a bad situation and try to see something good in it and be glad for it. And they called that the glad game. Pollyanna affected other people with her gladness and made them want to be glad too. Well, in the movie that I've watched many times, one of my favorite parts, Pollyanna has a conversation with someone. And in that conversation, Pollyanna shows them something special that her dad had given her. And the something special has something written on it. And it said, if you look for the bad in someone, you will surely find it. Why do we sometimes concentrate on the bad in a situation or the one thing that someone might have said to us that really hurt our feelings instead of the good in that person? Why don't we be like a Pollyanna who looks at the good in a situation or at the good in a person and try to be glad? Well, there have been a few people in my life who I recall over the years have said some things to me that really hurt my feelings. But out of respect, I realized my words would only make the situation worse, so I didn't say anything. Now, one of those persons is old and close to dying and going to sleep. And I am so glad I handled the situations that way, because in the end, this person loves me even more because I love them. And they knew they had been bad, but that I had loved them anyways. Even though Pollyanna's aunt was strict and not a happy person, Pollyanna loved her anyways. And this love changed her aunt. I am so grateful that Jesus looks at me that way. He might see some bad in me, but he concentrates on the good in me and never gives up on me. And that is one of the reasons I love Jesus so very much. I want to be like Jesus. If someone hurts my feelings, I forgive them and concentrate on the good in them. Doing this makes me happy. Jesus told the people in Matthew 12, verse 35, "The good man brings good things out of the good stored up in him." I hope you too want to be like Jesus and forgive others and concentrate on the good in them and to be a Pollyanna and play the glad game and look for the good in a bad situation. Who would like to pray? Noah?
Dear Father, thank you for this day. Help Pastor to preach a good sermon today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, everybody, get your sermonette forms. They're coming in kind of slow. And if you turn in a sermonette form back in the basket, I have some pretty cool stickers for you to get. So go ahead and grab your forms over here. And remember, after church, when you put the form in the basket, then you get the sticker. All right, get your forms.
It's that special time of the service when we get to take part in praying and bringing our petitions and our praises before the Lord. And I just want to remind you of the tab in your bulletin that you can fill out with your prayer requests, and you can place those in the offering plate or in the comments box in the back. And for those who have a special need upon their heart, you may come forward at this time, or you can kneel right where you are as we sing Spirit of the Living God together.
Heavenly Father, what a joy it is to be in the house, your house, this house, on this blessed day. We come to you, Father, to worship you in spirit and in truth. We've come to glorify your holy name. We've come to invite the Holy Spirit and angels to come into our presence and to bless us. We want to thank you, Father, for all that you have done for us, for the gift of Jesus and salvation. We thank you for this warm church that invites us week after week to come and to worship you and to glorify your holy name. This morning, as we have come, some down front, others in their pews, and yet some at home watching on the screen, we pray that a Holy Spirit will be present in each one of their lives. Help each one of us, Father, to feel you speaking to our hearts as we listen to the sermon this morning. We thank you, Father, for the many blessings that we have received, and sometimes so unworthy to receive them. We thank you, Father, for our visitors that are here today. We thank you for the guests that have come to worship with us. We lift them up to you also. And here, kneeling before you, are your children, many with heavy hearts, others with stress in their life. Some have come to praise you and to glorify your holy name. But whatever our needs are, we ask that you place your great arms of love around each one. Lift us up, hold us close to your bosom. May we feel your heartbeat within our life. May we be willing to go out and shine for Jesus today. We thank you for a nation that allows us to worship in freedom. We thank you, Father, for the religious liberties that we share and the opportunities that we have to tell others about your love. So this morning, as we enter into your presence, as we ask you to take all selfishness away from our thoughts, we ask that you will place your great arms of love around not only us, but our children, wherever they may be, grandchildren, those that perhaps have taken a different course. We ask that you'll bring them back to you. And may, Father, when it's all done and said, someday we will all stand in your presence and hear the good, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Those of you who have been precious to eyesight, who have done well here on earth, welcome into the joys of your salvation. Amen.
Good morning. Religious liberty is something very dear to my heart, and I invite those online to participate also, as you can give your offerings online. I don't know how many of you realize it, but with the stroke of a pen, the president can order anything that he considers an emergency. And as an example, at the state level, some of this will be history to younger folks, but to the older folks, you'll remember it. During the riots of 1967, the governor, Governor Romney at the time, made a proclamation that there was an emergency in the state. He also wrote an executive order. There were riots in four cities in Michigan, in Detroit, Lansing, Grand Rapids, and Flint. And his order was that all the streets had to be cleared. No cars, no businesses open, no gas stations open. Everybody had to be off the sidewalks and in their houses. And this was for the protection of the people. And as the night went on and the riots spread in different areas, it was our job in the office to keep expanding the description of the property where the military could go and the National Guard and the state police and so on. But I was thinking afterwards, you know, the president has that same authority and responsibility, really, in protecting the people. So whenever they decide there's some kind of an emergency, they can put out any kind of order that they want in order to bring it back to peace. So I just thought that gave me the feeling that I know what can happen with just the stroke of a pen. And now I'll go back to the text that I was supposed to use. Today's North American Division offering goes toward religious liberty. Scripture points to the day when we will not have religious liberty. That's why our offering today for religious liberty is important. The religious liberty offering sends Liberty Magazine to thought leaders in the community, including elected officials, judges, attorneys, and pastors of Sunday churches, among others. Many thought leaders have forgotten the lesson of history. Prophecy tells us that these lessons will be forgotten, which will result in church and state uniting again. Not only will sending liberty to thought leaders inform them of important religious liberty principles, but the Holy Spirit can use liberty to convict them of truth. The religious liberty offering also funds litigating the cases of church members who lose their jobs because they're not willing to work on Sabbath. Litigation is not cheap, but it's important to establish positive legal procedures to preserve our rights going forward. The cases of two Seventh-day Adventists, Adele Sherbert and Paula Hobby, who lost their jobs over the Sabbath, went to the United States Supreme Court. In each case, the Supreme Court ruled in their favor, establishing positive legal precedents, which benefited other church members. That reminds me, as I was doing research in the Capitol, one day I accidentally ran across a part of Michigan law that defines Seventh-day Adventists. And it really surprised me. And it simply says that we are people that observe the seventh day as our worship day. But I thought that was rather interesting, too. And to conclude, after the riots were settled down at 11 o'clock at night, I went to go out of the governor's office, and there was a state policeman there with a bayonet on his rifle. And they escorted me to my car and followed me out of town because no cars were supposed to be driving. So anyway, that I just wanted to emphasize how quickly things can happen and how quickly things can change. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to preserve our religious liberty. We thank you for those who work together on this, the attorneys and all the people involved. We ask you continue to bless and that we can keep the Sabbath day as you've directed. We ask it all in your name. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, church family. Would all that are able please stand for the reading of God's word? Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. May God bless the reading of his word. You may be seated.
Just as I'm sorry, one second, this moved on me. Start again. In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise. Come to Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, give me Jesus. For Jesus paid it all, to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. It is well, it is well with my soul, with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. And the day when my faith shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as the scroll, the trump shall resound, and the
soul. Just as I am, thou wilt receive.
Church family, happy Sabbath. Hope that you are well this morning. And I appreciate, Jason, that music. That was very beautiful to put us in the moment or the heart and spirit atmosphere that we need to be in. And I'm thankful for that. Happy New Year. I haven't been able to tell you that, really. I wasn't here last Sabbath. So I praise the Lord that He brought us through another year, yeah? 1 year closer to His soon return. How many of you are looking for and longing for that soon return, yes? And we praise God for that. Hasn't it been a beautiful Sabbath this morning? And I want to thank Sister Penny Ansel for our offering call this morning. And this sister has been through a lot in her life, and she has a lot of wonderful stories. And she is also, as I understand, celebrating her 85th birthday this week. So we want to praise the Lord for that. Amen. And she is still going strong. She's 85 years young. Amen. And when we think of ourselves in the eyes of eternity, we are not that old, no matter how old we think we are. Yes? And it depends on how young at heart we are. Yeah? Well, I wanted to, before we have prayer and get into our message this morning, it is 11:50, but no one's watching the clock, and we're all just praying and asking the Lord to bless us this morning. Amen? Amen. And I just wanted to quickly share with you, I went to Germany last week, as many of you know, and I preached for a youth congress there, similar to GYC, but it's called ATSYC, Adventist Theological Society Youth Congress. So I'll try to say that in German. Be in trouble, right? And so it was a great blessing. And the young people there, they were coming together. They wanted to study God's Word. And it was powerful, the love that they had for each other and what the Lord was doing in their lives. And many young people all across Germany came together. And on Sabbath, or I had the privilege of speaking throughout the weekend, I did a workshop. And then I also preached for the evening messages and the Sabbath morning. And on Sabbath, they had about 600 young people, ages, 15 to 30, from all over Germany, coming together to hear the Word of God. And it was just very exciting. The atmosphere, they do such a fine job. It's amazing what God can do through young people. Amen? Our entire denomination, our movement, the Adventist movement, was started by young people about 15 years old up to about 25 years old. And God moved on their hearts, and they were all studying the Word of God as teenagers and as young people in their early 20s. And God's Spirit was poured out upon them, and God revealed truths to them that are precious to us today. Amen? truths that are important for the climax of the Protestant Reformation. It's incredible. And these young people came, and so I had the privilege of preaching to them. And on Sabbath morning, and we made a couple of appeals, myself and another speaker. And by the end of the weekend, more than 20 young people gave their lives to the Lord for the first time and committed themselves to baptism, preparation for baptism. So we praise God for that. About another 10 young men came forward in a call to give themselves over to full-time, lifelong pastoral ministry. And so we praise God for that. I made a call, an invitation for any young people that felt the Lord calling them into pastoral ministry. And then I made another appeal. There was about 30 young people that came forward to commit to 1 year of their lives, or even 6 months or two, up to 2 years, a call for them to commit themselves full-time to ministry for 1 year or 2 years or 6 months. And about another 30 young people came. And then dozens more came forward at the invitation to wherever they are, whatever they're doing in life, whether they be a doctor, a lawyer, or a bus driver, it doesn't matter, that they would commit themselves to being a missionary for Christ wherever they went. And many more came forward. So we're praising the Lord. It was a blessing and great privilege. And to see the Holy Spirit working, it was very, very powerful. So I appreciate your prayers while I was gone. And I also went to a media ministry center and was able to record some programs for them that will be aired across Germany. So it was a great joy. And I learned a couple German words, verboten, which means forbidden. Don't enter here. And one thing about the German people is when they say 1 o'clock for an appointment, 1 o'clock is when the appointment is. Like, you're not late, even 30 seconds. This guy told me he'd come to my room every day to get me, to take me to the meals and to the meetings. And every day, on the minute, he was at my door knocking. I could guarantee it. So that's the German blood, right, Carmen? Amen. Order and structure and punctuality is the order of the day. So praise the Lord. Well, it's time for our message now. And I've got some tall marching orders from Noah this morning in his prayer. Pray the Lord would help the pastor preach a good sermon, right? So I'm thankful you're praying for me, Noah, and we look forward to that. This title is The Two Witnesses of the Two Witnesses. And you may have been wondering, what exactly is that, as you've seen that? And we're going to explore that. It's something that's been on my heart, and for some of you, it's going to be a comfort. For others of you, it's going to bring great conviction. For others of you, it's going to bring agonizing of soul. And so I hope you're prepared, and I'm just praying that the Lord is going to speak to your heart in the way that He wants to do that. Can we all pray that prayer this morning? And I don't know what the time is going to be. I plan for a good time, but you just pray, and the Lord will bless us. So let's pray together. You pray for me, and I'll pray for you. Sound good? All right. Father in heaven, this morning, as we open your scripture, as we consider counsel from the spirit of prophecy, I just pray, Lord, that you would come upon us, that you would draw us close, and that you would help us to see the blessing that we can receive from these things which we'll discuss this morning. I pray your Holy Spirit would cause us to be stirred, our hearts to be stirred. We would see the importance of things that we will discuss, and Lord, that your Spirit would convict us to make the right decisions and to make the right adjustments in our life, to be able to honor you in everything that we do. So we praise your name, Lord. We love you. We claim your righteousness by faith. And we know, Lord, that you have such a deep love for us, a love deeper than we can ever even imagine. So we ask your blessing now. We come in Jesus' name. Let all God's people say, amen. Now, if you go to the book of Revelation chapter 11, which we're not going to do right now, but if you go there, you can write it down and read it later. You read about two witnesses that the Bible talks about being killed and laid in the streets, and then they are eventually resurrected, right? And so the Bible talks about them. They, because of the word of their testimony, they are killed, and then they're laid in the streets for 3.5 days, and we've studied this before in our seminars on prophecy, and then they are raised to life, and they are called back up to heaven, right? How many of you remember, even in the spring, we studied this in the Revelation Unlock Revelation series. And many people always ask, who are the two witnesses? And who are they? How many of you know? Tell me if you know. Who are they? It's the Old and New Testament, right? The Bible talks about them, and in the book of Zechariah chapter 4, you can read the whole chapter. We're not going to read it this morning. You can write that down and go home and read it this afternoon. But in Zechariah chapter 4, it speaks about these two witnesses and that stand before two olive trees that stand before the throne of God. And the Bible says that they are the Word of God. And of course, there's two testaments to the Word of God, the Old and the New, right? And so they are the two witnesses, the Old and the New Testament. That's basic understanding. We understand that, right? But the question we want to ask this morning is, who are the two witnesses of the two witnesses? Well, yeah, that's true. You and me. That's a good answer. Not the one I have for today, but I could preach another sermon on that. Amen. So I have to ask you a question that will help us identify that. What are the two greatest corporate and sacred assemblies outside of divine worship that open God's Word and provide opportunities to study it and understand it better through prayer? Tell me what those two things are, if anybody can guess. Sabbath school, I heard it, and I heard a lot of stuff. What? Prayer meeting. You got it. The two witnesses of the two witnesses. Sabbath school and what, friends? Prayer meeting. Now, this is a new year, so you ought to expect a sermon like this from your pastor. Amen? How many of you would expect that from me, right? You know me. You would expect that. Sabbath school and prayer meeting. Now, I can't find a Bible verse to support that. Actually, I can, kind of a principle-wise, and we'll look at some of that. But Sabbath school and prayer meeting are the two witnesses of the two witnesses. They are the two services that testify that we have as an organized movement of Christians, of believers, that testify of the Word of God. We come to Sabbath school to study the Word of God. We come to prayer meeting to study the Word of God and to pray at both meetings that we may understand the Word of God more thoroughly. In the divine worship service, we are not able to fully break down things as we are in Sabbath school. Amen? So both are essential. So we're going to talk about both of those this morning for just a little bit. And we're going to see the importance of them. We're going to answer a number of questions. Somebody might ask, what is Sabbath school? Well, if you're visiting with us from a Sunday church, it's very similar to what? Sunday school, right? It's where you come together in a classroom type setting to study the Word of God and to do it on a personal level. So Sabbath school is an opportunity for members and guests to come together for the sole purpose of studying the Bible on a personal level. Right now, you're hearing the Word of God proclaimed on a public level. But Sabbath school offers us the opportunity to do it personally, interactively, yes? And it typically precedes the divine worship hour, so it's right before it. Now, Sabbath school has five main purposes. What are the five main purposes of Sabbath school? Number one, spiritual growth, nurture, and discipleship of old and new members. Which kind of members? Old and what? New. That means how many? That means all members, right? Number two, interactive, personal, and deep Bible study that disciples members. So in Sabbath school, in the worship hour, it's very important. Divine worship is very important. But you don't get that personal interaction. You don't get that personal connection, that personal study, right? So you get that in Sabbath school, and it's also interactive. Number three, small group fellowship that nurtures personal relationships. I often find people that say, well, you know, I come to church and I talk to people, but I don't really know them. How many of you ever heard somebody say that? I won't ask you to raise your hand, but how many of you have said that? I just don't feel like I know anybody. I get the and so what Sabbath school does is it gives you the opportunity in a small classroom setting to be able to interact with other believers. Amen? So some people say, well, we have such a big church. You know, it's impersonal. I don't get to know people. Well, Sabbath school is one of many opportunities you have to do that. Amen? Number four, opportunity for local outreach and soul winning. And, you know, this year, each department every month is going to be leading an outreach. And so Sabbath school was actually originally intended for new believers and people that weren't of our faith to come in and be able to learn about our truth and to be able to understand what we believe so that they can give their lives to Christ and follow Him. Amen? So Sabbath School fosters local outreach. And number five, if I can get my thing to work here, gives you an opportunity to participate and support in world mission. How many believe that world mission is important? Supporting our missionaries. We take up offerings in Sabbath School for missionaries. We have sometimes mission spotlight. We have mission projects through Sabbath School. How many of you think that you want to grow spiritually this morning? How many of you think that you want to be nurtured in your faith? How many of you think you need discipleship? Yeah? How many of you think you need interactive personal Bible study? How many of you think you need group fellowship and personal relationships with others? How many of you think you want to do or that we need to have local community outreach? Amen? And we need to support world missions. If you believe in those things that are core truths of Scripture, then you ought to know that Sabbath School is the place for you. Amen, Sabbath School teachers? Amen. So if, I'm going to say some cutting things in the sermon. I'm just going to let you know ahead of time. So if you don't attend Sabbath School, it could indicate that you think those things are what? Not important. It could. I'll let the Holy Spirit decide for you if it does. I'm not going to judge you. Notice this. I found this little gem, and it is so powerful. A little statement from the Elder's Handbook on page 100. It says, the Sabbath School program is the discipleship heart of the local church. Imagine that. Its aim is to win and train people of all ages as disciples of Jesus Christ. The Sabbath School class, in which members are taught Adventist beliefs and Bible beliefs, is the church's primary program to nurture members. It reinforces new believers in the church and strengthens fellowship in established members. Think about this, friends. If you're coming to church week after week and you're feeling yourself unnurtured, if you say, I don't feel like I have relationships with people, then you probably ought to go where? To Sabbath School. Amen? I have watched our Sabbath School teachers. They do a wonderful job of nurturing and caring for our members. When they're sick in the hospital, I've seen them visit them. They have fellowship meals together. They have wonderful personal interactions. Amen? Sabbath School is the place to be. Now, what is the biblical support for Sabbath School? Deuteronomy chapter 4, I read that for our baby dedication, so I'm not going to reread it to you. But the emphasis there was that God told the children of Israel to teach the commandments of the Lord to their children and to the other people, yes? So teaching is involved. And if you go there to Acts chapter 2, do we do teaching in Sabbath School, yes or no? In the divine service, we do proclamation of the word. In Sabbath School, we do teaching and studying of the word. Go with me to the book of Acts chapter 2, and we're going to take a look at a verse here. Acts chapter 2. And verse 41 and 42. It says, if you're there, say amen. It says, and then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. And notice what it says here. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and in fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in prayers. And so some people say, well, doctrine doesn't really matter. It's not really that important. But apparently, Jesus thought it was important. The apostles thought it was important. The early church thought it was important. And because the Bible talks about it over and over. Amen? So the Bible says that they continued and they studied, they broke bread, and in prayers. And so that sounds a lot like, guess what? Sabbath School. What do you think? Sounds a lot like that. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1 and 4, you can write that down and read it later, but Paul says that we should, the truths which we have received, we should commit to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. So there's that word again, teaching. Are you guys awake this morning? Teaching, which is Sabbath. I didn't put this one up there, but in Ephesians chapter 5, it talks about men receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit to be equipped for ministry. And one of those gifts is teaching. So Sabbath School has a very biblical base. So some people ask, well, why should I personally attend Sabbath school? Right? Why should I personally attend? What blessing will I get more than extra sleep? Some people say, well, I don't go to Sabbath school because I like to sleep a little bit later on Sabbath morning. How does it help me, and how does it help others and the church? So you ready? Let's take a look at this. Let's see what it says. What divine influence will Sabbath school have on my life personally? It's a great book called Counsels on Sabbath School Work. And this comes from page 10 of that book. It says, the Sabbath school is an important branch of the missionary work, not only because it gives to young and old a knowledge of God's word, but because it awakens in them a love for its sacred truths and a desire to study them for themselves. Above all, it teaches them to regulate their lives by its holy teachings. Think about that. So Sabbath school does a lot of things for us, doesn't it? It makes us missionaries. It gives us a knowledge of God's word. It gives us a love for the sacred truths of Scripture. And it gives us a desire to study them. It teaches us how, by grace through faith, strength of God, not our own strength, righteous by faith, amen, Doug, how to align our lives with the truths and the principles of the Word of God, the Holy Scriptures. Amen? So how many of you think by this statement that Sabbath school seems like it ought to be pretty important to us? What do you think this morning? How many of you think that today, yeah? Let's ask another question. How does my individual personal attendance to Sabbath school strengthen the church? Does your personal attendance matter in Sabbath school? Let's see. There are sacred responsibilities entrusted to Sabbath school workers, and the Sabbath school should be the place where, through a living connection with God, men and women, youth and children may be so fitted up that they should be a strength and a blessing to the church. How many can say amen? You're not sleeping, right? All right. They should help the church on upward and onward as far as it lies in their ability, going from strength to greater what? Greater strength. So does your presence at Sabbath school make a difference to the church, yes or no? It does, because Christ uses your presence to strengthen the church. The talents that you have, the abilities that God has given you, when you surrender those to use them for the Lord's service, He strengthens you to strengthen the church. How many could say amen? Praise the Lord, yeah? Oh my goodness. Lord help us. Y'all are doing, some of you are doing what some of you do during Sabbath school time. All right, let's wake up here. How should parents value taking their children to Sabbath school? What do you think? The Sabbath school affords precious opportunities and privileges for the young. Parents should highly prize these advantages and show their children that they appreciate them. If they manifest no decided interest in the school themselves, they cannot expect their children to do so. In the Sabbath school, parents may be learners as well as the children. Both parents and children should seek to have a knowledge of the Scriptures. Other books should be what? Secondary to the Word of God. Secondary. Yeah? Here's another statement. Even greater care should be taken by the parents to see that their children have their Sabbath school lessons. That is, taken to see that their day school lessons are prepared. Their Sabbath school lessons should be learned more perfectly than their lessons in the common schools. Ever thought about that? That means that is math important? Is science important? Is English important? It's important, but what's most important? What's going to fit them for eternity? Now, English, math, and all these things, we need to do them. I'm not saying don't do them. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying. But what's more important, to prepare them to be successful in this life or to build their characters for the next life? Both are important, but we're told that one is more important. Amen? You understand? So don't misunderstand that I'm not saying that the other is not important, but this is most important. If parents and children see no necessity for this interest, then the children might better remain at home, for the Sabbath school will fail to prove a blessing to them. Parents and children should work in harmony with superintendents and teachers. thus giving evidence that they appreciate the labor put forth for them. Parents should take special interest in the religious education of their children. They may have a more thorough knowledge of the scriptures. Parents, is Sabbath school important for your kids? It is very important. Over in Europe, they told me that they do not call it Sabbath school. They call it divine service, part one and part two. So the Sabbath school is actually like part of the divine service. Does that make sense? It's just part one and part two. Now I have someone who's going to come up and give just a real quick testimony and about what Sabbath school means to her. So Carmen, if you would just come on up and the pulpit mic here, and what a blessing Sabbath school is to her.
Good morning, church family. Sabbath school is part of church. I cannot imagine church without Sabbath school because it's just part of it. It would be just not complete. I grew up as a Seventh-day Adventist, and I always went to Sabbath school. It started in cradle roll, and I went all the way to youth, and then back to the adult Sabbath school. I love Sabbath school. I give you a couple reasons why. You get to know your brothers and sisters much more as you're sitting in the pew. You can hear different opinions. You study a subject all week long, and you maybe haven't understood it. And maybe somebody else was enlightened by the Holy Spirit to explain it to you. And it really lifts, we can lift each other up through this. Sometimes I just sit in Sabbath school class and listen because I'm just amazed what other people have gotten out of the same Bible text. I've gotten nothing out of it. There's times we laugh together. There's times we cry together. In the beginning, we collect prayer requests and praises to lift each other up. And we carry, as individuals, we carry each other through the week through prayer. So Sabbath school for me is like a family. I think Sabbath school kept me in church, and I just tell you, if you don't come to Sabbath school, you are missing out.
How many can say amen? How many can say praise the Lord? So what reasons do people give for not attending Sabbath school? You tell me. My alarm didn't go off. Okay. What else? Huh? Too tired. Yeah. They say, man, it's my Sabbath. I want to sleep. But it doesn't say anywhere in the Bible that the Sabbath is our Sabbath or my Sabbath. It says it's whose Sabbath? It's the Sabbath of the Lord. It's the day meant for worship, service, and giving myself to Him, right? And so do you understand? Are you starting to see here? Now, bless your hearts. I love you, church family, and this is why I give you these things. Are you starting to understand the importance of attending Sabbath school rather than sleeping in? What do you think? Because every week you sleep in, Satan robs you. He robs you. You like, it's like going to bed and like leaving your door unlocked and saying, free stuff in my house, just come in and take it while I sleep. That's what you're doing. Satan wants to rob you of the blessings that God wants to get you. Now, I want to make something clear today, very clear. I'm not trying to make anyone feel guilty, not trying to put pressure on you to do something you don't want to do, but I am trying to help you see the blessings that you lose and the blessings that you miss when you allow Satan to rob you of the precious joys and blessings of the Sabbath school divine service part one. Amen? Is everybody clear on that? All right, look at this. What counsel is given for all my reasons not to attend Sabbath school? Watch this. Same book, Counsel on Sabbath School Work, page 19. It says, parents plead trifling excuses for not interesting themselves in the lessons with their children, and they fail to become conversant with the scriptures. Fathers as well as mothers excuse themselves from disciplining their own minds. They do not seek first the kingdom of God and its righteousness, but exalt the temporal above the spiritual and eternal. This forgetfulness of God and neglect of His Word is the example they give their children. What example do you want your kids to have? Which example? Which molds their minds after the worldly standard and not after the exalted standard erected by Christ. engaged in searching the scriptures that they may be thoroughly furnished to all good works. When and where can this be better obtained than at the Sabbath school? The blessings, the opposite impact. So what impact does it have on me and my family to not attend Sabbath school? Let's see what it says. I'm just giving you the straight counsel here. It says, it is a sad failure. They are always behind time on Sabbath morning. They are very particular about their own time, but they cannot afford to lose an hour of that. But the Lord's time, the day, only day out of the seven that the Lord claims is His and requires us to devote to Him, quite a portion of this is squandered away by sleeping late. Somebody actually knew this would be a problem in our day and age, didn't they? They wrote about it 100 years ago. In this, they are robbing God. It causes them to be behind in everything. It makes confusion in the family. Now, parents, I'm trying to be gentle and loving here. But if you do not bring your kids to Sabbath school, I'm not trying to rebuke you or judge you, but when you don't bring your kids to Sabbath school, it creates confusion in your family. Confusion. That leads to greater confusion, spiritual confusion. And finally results in the tardiness of the entire family at Sabbath school and perhaps at meeting. The statement continues. And what is the solution for the reasons not to attend Sabbath school? It continues. It says, now why can we not rise early with the birds and offer praise and thanksgiving to God? Is that legalistic? What do you think? No, not at all. Try it, brothers and sisters. Have your preparations all made the day before and come promptly to the Sabbath school and meeting, and talking about divine worship, and you will thereby not only benefit others, but you will reap rich blessings for yourselves. How many of you want rich blessings? How many of you want to be a blessing to someone else? It's so much greater to be a blessing to someone else even than it is to receive the blessings of God yourself. Amen? But we can be a blessing to others. Amen? So, again, benefits of attending Sabbath school. It strengthens my love for God and His Word. How many of you want to have that experience? Yeah? It disciples me in the truth and builds my character. How many of you think that's a blessing? Yeah? It equips me to be a missionary. It gives me opportunity to be part of a global mission work. It provides me with small group fellowship and study. It strengthens the local church, and it has eternal value in life. How many of you think those are great reasons to come to Sabbath school? Do you think it enough to make the cost to come, to readjust your life in 2017 to be at Sabbath school? Do you think it valuable enough? I don't know. That's up to you. I can't make that decision for you, but you have to ask yourself that question. What should we do? Jesus said, where your treasure is, there also, there your heart also, right? We need to choose today whom we're going to serve, and we need to choose to invest. What do you think this morning? How many of you think that's valuable counsel today? Well, what about the prayer meeting? This one's not quite as long. What about the prayer meeting this morning? The other witness. You can't have one without two, right? Notice this. What exactly is prayer meeting? Prayer meeting is an opportunity for members and guests, these are my own words, to come together for midweek fellowship, midweek prayer time, and Bible study to give us a spiritual boost of encouragement and strength between Sabbaths. How many of you have temptations all week long? How many of you find trials in your life throughout the week, yes? That midweek prayer meeting is designed to allow you to come together and to have a season of prayer, a season of Bible study, a season of testimonies and uplifting, strengthen us against the enemy's attack on us and our children through the week. Yes? Now, let me just say this before I move on. I want to make this disclaimer. I understand that there's no reason for anybody to miss Sabbath school, but I understand that there are circumstances sometimes that cause people to miss prayer meeting. We have young children. My wife can't attend. My kids got to go to bed. You understand? She has a prayer meeting with them at home. Some people work in the evenings. Some people our sick or whatever, our community service center folks, bless their hearts. They work so hard over there. I go over there and I have a prayer meeting with them at time, so they don't come to the evening one. But for those of us who don't have any other obligations and we're just deciding to stay at home, this may speak to you. I'm going to give you, you can write these down. I'm not going to do all these, but I am going to go through two of them. If you'll go with me to Mark chapter 14, Mark chapter 14, and notice what Jesus says here, Mark chapter 14, and verse 38. Mark 14 and verse 38. Jesus says, watch and what? Pray. And he's talking to two sleeping disciples. Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak. How many of you, I say this lovingly and in a humorous way, how many of you have thought to yourself on a Wednesday evening, man, I really should go to prayer meeting, but you ended up not going because the spirit is willing, but the flesh is what? Well, you ever had that experience before? You thought, man, I really should go, and I want to go, but the flesh is weak, right? God identifies with this, and that's the exact reason that we should go. Does that make sense? That's the exact reason we should go, because we are weak, because we are in the flesh, and we need that strength. We need that channel of the Holy Spirit to come and touch our hearts, that we may love Him more deeply, and it may be a blessing to us. Amen? Go with me to Luke chapter 18, verse 1. Luke chapter 18 and verse 1. And verse 1, it says, then he spoke a parable to them, that men always ought to pray and not do what? And not lose heart. In Isaiah 56, God says, my house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations. Now let me just say this. Some of you are very faithful attending prayer meeting, and I appreciate that. Some of you just flat out can't come to prayer meeting because you're working or you got some special circumstance. And I understand that. You can have prayer meeting at home. But for those of us who can't attend, do you think if Jesus gives us this counsel, do you think it's a benefit to us to go? What do you think? Yes or no? Do you think that we ought to go? We ought to go. Notice this statement here from the book Steps to Christ. It's a beautiful passage. It says, make every effort to keep communion between Jesus and your soul. Seek every opportunity to go where prayer is want or able to be made. Those who are really seeking for communion with God will be seen where? At the prayer meeting. Faithful to do their duty and they're earnest and anxious to reap all the benefits they can gain. Are there benefits from prayer meeting? What do you think? There are benefits. They will improve every opportunity by placing themselves where they can receive the rays of light from heaven. So how important should I personally view prayer meeting for my own benefit? How important do you think? Very important, yeah? You guys sleeping yet? I'll just keep asking that, and when I don't hear anything, by 3 o'clock, we'll just cut. No, I'm just kidding. We're not too far off. What does the prayer meeting indicate about the church and my own life, the condition? Look at this from a selection of testimonies. Prayer meeting will always tell the true interest of the church members in spiritual and eternal things. The prayer meeting is the pulse to the body. It denotes the true spiritual condition of the church. A lifeless, backslidden church has no relish for the prayer meetings. Because when we pray together, we become convicted of sin in our lives, and we are faced with a Savior. But the good news is that when God reveals sin to us in the prayer meeting, personally, speaks to our hearts, He's compassionate and loving. And if we confess our sins, He's what? Faithful and just to forgive us. Amen? It's a blessing. I've been in churches where I've had the prayer meeting, and just two little old ladies showed up. Two little old ladies. The visitors. And the question that the visitors asked me was what? Where are your people? I've been asked that question too many times, and it's quite difficult for me to answer it. I don't like answering it. And for the love of God, church family, you shouldn't put me in a position where I should have to answer it as your pastor. Amen? Told you it'd be a little painful this morning, but you love me and I love you. Amen? The Lord is with us. Is there a cost to pay in experiencing the spiritual blessings of prayer meeting? Let's ask that question. The conflict in which you have to take an active part is found in your everyday life. Will you not in times of trial lay your desires by the side of the written word and in earnest prayer seek Jesus for counsel? So what has to happen for us to make a commitment to the prayer meeting? We have to do what, friends? Lay aside our what? Our desires. Many declare that it is certainly no harm to go to a concert or fill in the blank with that. That's just what is written here in the 1800s. And neglect the prayer meeting. Soccer game, football game, television program, whatever. Or absent themselves from meetings where God's servants are to declare a message from heaven. It is safe for you to be just where Christ has said he would be. And where is Christ in the prayer meeting? At the prayer meeting. Amen? What do you think this morning? What are reasons people give not to attend? Tired. I'm tired too. What else? I'm busy. It's raining. It's snowing. I'm glad you brought that up because I have a slide here, but I'll mention it now. I'm reading this book right here. It's a great book, Passion, Purpose, and Power. It's stories of the Adventist pioneers. And did you know that they would work all day on the farm, and then they would travel like 5 to 7 miles, sometimes by foot, to go to the prayer meetings? Very interesting. Now, sometimes people say, well, I don't get much out of prayer meeting. Depends on who's teaching it, and pastor, when you teach, I get, but if someone else, I don't get anything out of it. But here's the thing. Let me ask this. If you're not getting anything out of prayer meeting, with whatever you are replacing that hour with at your home, is that giving you a greater blessing than you would receive at the prayer meeting? You understand what I'm saying here? Whatever you're doing instead of prayer meeting, is that giving you a greater spiritual renewal? Because if it is, you come talk to me and we'll come to your house and have prayer meeting. Amen? I'll be glad to do that. But think about that, friends. I just mentioned that. If I have taken the time, here's the thing. If I want to get a blessing out of, Sabbath school, if I want to get a blessing out of divine service, it does not depend on who's leading it. Does that make sense? It does not depend upon who's teaching. It doesn't matter who's preaching that Sabbath morning. It doesn't matter. How do I receive the greatest blessing? It is when I have spent the week myself and allowing God to speak to my heart through my own personal devotions. Are you with me? That's how it happens. What, if I've taken that time to prepare, what spiritual blessing can I expect God to give me? What? Notice what it says. I resolved to give myself unreservedly to the Lord. I commenced there to seek the Lord with all my heart. My mind was in great distress, but at a prayer meeting, I found what? Relief. Oh, how sweet was the peace of mind. Everything seemed changed. Some of you think prayer meeting can be a blessing to you. I'm losing you. Are you awake? Don't perish on me yet. Be awake. Be diligent. Amen? Don't repeat Peter, James, and John falling asleep, right? I have another quick testimony from Tim Yorty, who's going to come and talk about prayer meeting. I appreciate Tim because Tim is faithful to prayer meeting every week. I can count on him, and that's why I asked him to share this.
Well, not every week.
Most every week. Unless there's a problem.
In 2012... God gave me a wake-up call. And I have to tell you, since then, he has given me so many blessings, I can't count them. And I wasn't going to prayer meeting. And then I started prayer meeting later in the summer of 2012, and those blessings multiplied exponentially. And you talk about sleep. the weeks that I don't go to prayer meeting, I don't sleep as well after that. I sleep better when I actually go to prayer meeting. And it's important to me because, first, we don't have a lot of time left. And I think all of you here know that. And the pastor gave us a bunch of references here. The Bible tells us, pray without ceasing. And I don't do that, so I need to continue to learn to do that. And a couple of weeks ago, I gave a quote from First Selected Messages, page 122. Who remembers what it was? Pray more, talk less. So I don't have anything, any better place to go. Like the blessings that Pastor said, if I could find something better to get a better spiritual blessing than be on prayer meeting, that's where I would be. Because I want to be where Jesus is. And I find Jesus is at the prayer meetings.
Amen. Thank you. And certainly Jesus can be everywhere. If you can't be at the prayer meeting, he's with you at home. But don't neglect. How many of you find that you just wrestle with temptation all week? Yeah? I mean, you have it. Why not take advantage of every opportunity you can to overcome that temptation? Amen? That's the point I'm trying to make this morning. So how can I get the greatest blessing out of both Sabbath school and prayer meeting? We're drawing to a close here. Notice this. How can I get the blessing out of both? Before leaving home, go to God in secret prayer. Plead with him for his blessing, and he who seeth in secret will shall reward thee openly. With your heart softened by the love of Jesus, go to the meeting, Sabbath school or prayer meeting, feeling that you are personally responsible for its success. Think about that. Think to yourself, man, if I'm not there, it's going to break the meeting. That's the mindset that God will give us when we go to him in prayer. Amen? If but few attend, you should feel under what kind of responsibility? Double responsibility. If there's a few there, you think to yourself, man, if I'm not there, that's one less. God wants me to be there. You are in the service of God. Who? You. And should do what you can, and with your talent, tact, and skill, to make his worship interesting. Amen? So it's not up to the pastor to make it interesting. It's not up to the person even leading the prayer meeting to make it interesting. It's up to all of us, because all of us are like a little piece of the puzzle. Amen? And we need to be there. What do you think? So friends, I have a question for you as we close. What were your priorities in 2016? Were they where they should have been? Examine your own hearts this morning. No one's judging you. No one's condemning you. I'm not making you feel bad. I'm just bringing it to your mind, and the Holy Spirit can deal with you as he desires. But what were your priorities in 2016? Some of you were in Pathfinders. That's your, on Wednesday night, that's your prayer meeting. You understand? But if you were sitting at home doing nothing when you could have been there, where were your priorities? If so, if your priorities were where they should be, will you deepen them this year? How many of you would deepen them? If your priorities were not where they should be in 2016, now Sabbath school and prayer meeting is just two of many things, will you make the decision today, by the grace of God, to correct in 2017? Will you make the decision today? How many of you will make that decision today? That when you can, when you're able, by the grace of God, you will feel a personal responsibility to be there for the sake of your soul and others. And those who don't know Christ are going to be there, because Sabbath school and prayer meeting can be a missionary opportunity. We have the 10 days of prayer that's going on right now for the rest of this week and next week through Friday night at 7 to 8 o'clock. I want to encourage you to come. You will receive a blessing. How many of you who have gone have been, it's been a blessing? Yeah? And then following that, on January 25th, Wednesday night, we're going to begin a new 10-part series during prayer meeting on the parables of Jesus. We're going to talk about end times. We're going to talk about personal character. We're going to talk about practical Christianity. And I want to encourage you, if you can. I'm not trying to lay it on you if you can. I understand people have circumstances. But if you can, commit to it. What should we do today, friends? What should we do? If the Lord is God, do what? Serve Him. Serve Him with all of our hearts, with all of our minds, and with all of our strength. How many of you want to make that decision this morning? Would you make the decision today to choose to invest your family and yourselves and the kingdom of God in 2017? How many of you want to make that decision this morning? Amen? And Jesus, by the grace of God, can make it happen in our lives, and by doing so, it'll transform us. Amen? He's calling us. Let us respond and be faithful. Yeah? Amen. Let's all stand together as we sing our closing song, number 602. What a fitting song for our message this morning. Oh, brother and sister, be faithful. Number 602. I first came into the church and I used to attend Sabbath school. I was 22 years old, and there was a sister, Sister Brantley, I'll never forget her, from Oakwood College in Huntsville, Alabama, and she would prepare that lesson all week, and she was about 96 years old, and it took all of her strength and to teach that Sabbath school lesson, but she would faithfully come, and I thought to myself, If she's willing to do that at 96 years old, it's my duty, it's my obligation to be there because she's making that commitment as well, amen? And I decided in my heart that that would be my commitment as well, to be there and to grow in Jesus. We have wonderful Sabbath school teachers. We have wonderful Sabbath school classes from babies to adults. Let's take advantage of it, amen? The blessing that the Lord has given to us. Let's be faithful. Father in heaven, this morning, thankful today for the gifts you've given us, the two witnesses, the Old and the New Testament, the Word of God that speaks to our hearts today, that stirs us and awakens us to our need of you. And Lord, also the two witnesses, of the two witnesses that you have given to us as gifts in our movement. You've given them to us as a special blessing in which we can come together as brothers and sisters and encourage each other and pray for one another and strengthen each other to study your word and to be on our knees before you. Oh Lord, may we be faithful today. May we make the commitment today, if we can, to be there all that we can. So we praise your name who gives us the strength and the grace, Lord, to make it possible. We're not trying to earn salvation or earn merit, but Lord, we're just trying to receive more grace. We just want to have all the grace and all the blessings that you want. May you bless us this year, we pray, in Jesus' sweet name, as we look for his soon return. But all God's people say, amen.